go. Can you see my hand?
Yes, ma'am.
1, 2, 3. Good enough?
Yeah.
Okay. You're good?
All right. Cell phone's off.
Yes. All right. Mr. Bond, tell me how and why did you get involved in the Atlanta student movement?
Well, I got in the movement because I was sitting in Yates and Milton's drugstore, killing time between classes, and a student came up to me named Lonnie King, whom I knew because he was a football player at Morehouse. We didn't have any kind of football team, but I knew him as a football player. And he held up a newspaper to me and he said, "Have you seen this?" And I thought he meant, "Do you read a newspaper?" And I thought every college student read a newspaper every day, and I was a little put off by the question. And he said, "No, no, this story, and the story about students in North Carolina A&T College sitting in for the third or fourth day." And he said, "Have you seen that?" And I said, "Yeah, I've seen that." He said, "What do you think about it?" I said, "I think it's great, it's wonderful." He said, "Don't you think it ought to happen here?" And before I could say, "What do you mean, we?" He said, "You take this side of the drugstore, and I'll take this other side, and we'll get something going." And I should say there's a third person in this group, Joe Pierce, who was part of the founding of the Committee on Appeal for Human Rights. So we went around to different tables and talked to different people and asked them if they thought, you know, it was worthwhile to do something like that here in Atlanta, and tried as best we could to make sure it wasn't all Morehouse, it wasn't all Clark, it wasn't all Spelman. It was difficult to make it Mars Brown because Mars Brown was a few blocks away. But over time, we made sure we had somebody from all of these schools and from Atlanta University, because we didn't want it to be a Morehouse thing or a Spelman thing alone. We wanted it to be all of the schools involved. And a couple of weeks after we began this planning, we got a notice that Dr. Clement, Rufus Clement, who was the president of Atlanta University, and in effect the president of this whole compound, wanted to see us. Well, that was a little nervy, you know, and the president of the university wants to see you. Don't have to be worried about that. He called us into his office. He said, "I know what you're going to do. I can't stop you from doing it. But before you do it, you need to find some way to let Atlanta know why you're doing it." Well, I thought, you know, we're doing it because we can't sit at these lunch counters, and we want to sit at these lunch counters. That's why we're doing it. But anyway, he was insisting. And so he suggested that we write a statement. And I, with Rosalind Brock, not Rosalind Brock, that's a cop, president of the NAACP, Rosalind Pope, others put together this statement, an appeal for human rights. And we based it in part on a statement drawn up by a group of older men in the community called, I can't remember what the name was, but Carl Holman, professor at Clark, was one of them. And he had written this book, this little booklet, complaining about the inequities that black people in Atlanta face. And with that as a guide, we put together this statement called An Appeal for Human Rights. And we listed the inequities that black people in Atlanta face, segregated schools, segregated buses, segregated movie theaters, all those things, and closed it by saying, we intend to take every means at our disposal to eliminate these things. We got the presidents of all of the student bodies at all of the schools to sign it, and we took it back to Dr. Clement. Dr. Clement went to Lillian Smith, white woman, a novelist who had written a controversial book about an interracial love affair in Georgia, and she provided the money for this to be put in an ad, and we put it in the Atlanta Daily World, in the Atlanta Constitution, and the Atlanta Journal. And it was published in each of those papers as a full-page ad, and it caused an enormous controversy in white Atlanta. We talked a moment ago about Governor Vandiver saying this was not written by our students. Students couldn't write this. And I was so insulted by that because I had written part of this thing. Why do you think I couldn't do it? Was I not clever enough? He said it sounded as though it had been written in Moscow, if not Peking. I've never been to Moscow or Peking. I just thought, you know, this was the typical example of the racist element in the larger society around us, that they didn't believe we were capable of doing this. But anyway, but that's how I got involved in the movement, and next thing I knew is, here we go.
How old were you?
I was, this is 1960, I was 20 years old.
So I understand that the movement was like very militarily, strategically Can you tell us some of the ways that you plan for these demonstrations?
Well, with everything that we did, we talked about it beforehand and said, shall we do this? No, let's do this. Or let's do this plus this. Or let's not do that, let's do this instead. So we didn't just jump up and run downtown and say, let's sit at these lunch counters. It's much more sophisticated than that. And this first sit-in, we divided, I can't remember how many different places we went, but I was in charge of taking a group to Atlanta City Hall. And this is before this big addition had been put on the back. So it was these stairs going up the front. You walked in the front door, and you then went downstairs to the ground floor where the cafeteria was. And I led a group of students from Spelman and Morehouse, most of them, who went to this cafeteria. And I led this group into the cafeteria. And the first thing we saw was these black women were working at the steam tables. And we went through there, and these women, I could tell, were looking at us with a mixture of fear and admiration. Fear, because they knew we were doing some of these sit-ins that they'd heard about, they'd read about in the newspaper, happening other places in the South. And admiration, because they were part to be going to be part of some kind of history. Fear, because they knew policemen are coming, and you know, black people don't like to be around policemen. At least they didn't then, and probably don't now. But we came to the steam table, they gave us their food, we came to the cashier, who was a white woman. I later discovered she was the manager of the cafeteria, and she said, she's like a Southern, like many Southerners, very polite. She said, I'm awfully sorry, this is for City Hall employees only. I said, you got a big sign out front, it says City Hall Cafeteria, the public is welcome. She said, we don't mean it. And I would have fallen down laughing here. Do we need to stop?
Some miscellaneous working.
I found out this woman was the manager of the cafeteria, and she said, I'm awfully sorry, this is for City Hall employees only. And I said, you have a big sign on the grass outside that says City Hall Cafeteria, the public is welcome. She said, we don't mean it. And of course, I would have laughed in her face, but it was a serious moment. She said, if you don't leave now, I'm going to call the police and you'll be arrested and taken away. And so I said, we'll stay here until you allow us to eat here. And they called the police. The police came very quickly. I think Captain Little, who was a well-known Atlanta policeman, and one of the reasons why Atlanta didn't have the kind of police brutality that other cities did, I think he was sort of a sober figure there. But anyway, he came and locked us up and put us in a paddy wagon, and all of us were taken to jail. And none of us had been in jail before, and all of us, of course, were terrified at the idea of being behind bars, separated the men from the women, and put us in separate cells. And we're put in this big cell with, I'd say, about 100 men. And of course, the first thing when I saw these other men, I thought, why are they here? I know why I'm here. Why are they here? And I thought it was not proper etiquette to say, my good man, what brings you here? So I didn't say any of those things. But they knew why we were here, and they were happy to see us and proud of what we had done. And so this is the first reinforcement we got from what we had done, because the other prisoners knew why we were there. And whatever reason they were there, they were happy we had done what we were. They were proud of us, and they let us know that they were proud of us. And because so many people were arrested and so many different people, the strategy was that there would be one person tried for each group, and I was chosen to be tried for my group. So I found myself in a courtroom for the first time in my life, standing between two men whom I was informed were my lawyers, whom I'd never seen before, never known before. This was Donald Hollowell, the younger man, and Austin Walden, the older man. I'm standing between these two men, and there's a little back and forth between my lawyers, and then the judge. And I really don't understand what they're talking about. And all of a sudden, the judge looked at me and said, how do you plead? Well, of course, I'd seen this on TV. How do you plead? And I knew that I had refused to follow the policeman's order when he ordered me to leave. So I had to be guilty of something. On the other hand, I didn't feel like I was guilty. I had a right to be in this. This is a tax-supported place. I was a taxpayer in Georgia. I had a right to be here, and I had every right to be there just like the judge did. But so I didn't know, am I guilty? Am I not guilty? What should I say? So I looked to Colonel Walden, who I have to tell you was sort of nodding off like this. And so he was no help. So I turned to Donald Hollowell, who was the younger of the two men, and he said, not guilty, you fool. And so I was quick enough to drop those last two words, or else I might not be sitting here right now. So that's how I got in the movement. And then I got bailed out, as the rest of the state got bailed out later that day. And I remember going to Spelman, because I thought my heroism needed to be reflected in the eyes of the Spelman co-ed. And I can't remember what we did, but I went over to Spelman with somebody else, so we could say, you know, we were just arrested. Of course, there were girls from Spelman, or young women from Spelman who'd been arrested too, but I don't think they felt the same way about it.
Great story. Did you hear it?
No.
So did you get any play?
Did you get any play?
That's for another story.
When you were planning, Lonnie was telling me a story about, I don't remember the gentleman's name, I think it was Bennett or something, planned out everything. He was ex-military, and we had names like Commandante and that type of thing. What was your name? What was your position?
I didn't have a name, except my own name. But I don't know why, but I'd always been interested in writing. And while a student at Morehouse, I wanted somehow to become a writer. And I had helped to found a literary magazine at Morehouse called The Pegasus, and published that for a couple of issues. So I was just bent toward writing. And somehow or another, I found myself saying, I'm going to be the publicist. I'm going to be the guy who talks to the media. I'm going to be the person who tells the media what we've done and why we've done it and so on. I'm going to be the interlocutor between the movement and the media. And so that's the role I fell into. And I don't know how I got into that role, or who said, okay, or that's all right, you can do it. But that's the role I undertook. And so I became the PR person for the movement. So over the next several years, after the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee was founded, I took on that job for them. But I took that job first for the Atlanta Student Movement. And I got to know all of the reporters who covered civil rights. There's one guy named Raleigh Bryan. I'm just rethinking his name here. I'm sure he's going on to his reward now, but he was sympathetic to the movement, and he covered the movement for it. Another one named Fred Powledge, who worked for the Journal or Constitution, one of those two papers, and he covered us with some decency and thoughtfulness. I got to know the New York Times reporter, who was among the most important person to know, because if you get in the New York Times, you're really big time. His name was Claude Sitton, and he created the little reporter's notebook that you see, like it's about this big. And what he did was he took a regular notebook and cut it in half, and that was what was left. And he could put it in his coat, and nobody would see it, and he pulled it out and pulled it out again. So I got to know him, and I got to know that he was a person worth being close to, and somebody who would treat us fairly, who would tell our story the way we wanted it to be told, wouldn't stretch anything, wouldn't tell lies or anything about us. But he was a good guy, and having him on your side was like gold.
Wow, what an experience. At one point, the newspaper, we're talking about these articles, newspaper account said that the marchers seemed to suddenly appear, leaving the KKK always a step behind, not knowing where to stage their counter demonstration. How were you able to do that?
I think we were quick, we were young, we got from here to there very quickly. We decided if they're over here, we're going to go over there. Or we may even go where they are and show them that we're not afraid of them. You know, typically, in every city in the South, where the Ku Klux Klan showed its face, black people ran like this. But we weren't going to run from anybody. We wanted to do anything to show these people we were afraid of them, because we were not afraid of them. They looked silly with these little hats. You know why they wear those pointed hats? That's to make up for physical inadequacies in other parts of their bodies. That was our attitude toward these people. They looked stupid. They looked foolish. And we weren't going to let them push us around.
Was Martin Luther King ever consulted by the group or did anything with the group?
Lonnie King was attended Ebenezer Baptist Church, and he knew Dr. King as his pastor. And I knew him because I took a class that he taught at Morehouse College. You know, a lot of people they were students of Dr. King's. He only taught one time, only taught one class, only 8 people in the class. I'm one of the 8. So if you hear somebody say that he was a student of Dr. King's and he wasn't in that class, he's telling a big lie. But I was a student, so I knew Dr. King from that. And Lonnie knew him from being his in his congregation at Ebenezer Baptist Church. And when we were going to sit in at Rich's, because Rich's was the biggest store, still is, I guess. And if you could break the back of Rich's, you break the back of segregation in restaurants in Atlanta. So we wanted badly for King to be arrested with us, because we thought, and Lonnie thought, that if we could get Dr. King arrested in Atlanta, and you know, this was right in the middle of a presidential campaign, John F. Kennedy and Richard Nixon vying for which of them is going to be president of the United States. Each of them will be forced to make some comment about this. And the one that makes the best comment is going to be the recipient of black votes. And so we, in effect, helped influence the outcome of the presidential election in 1960. Because after King was arrested, his campaign apparatus put together a phony group of black clergymen, including the leadership of it was William Gray, who was the father of the late Congressman William Gray. And they put together this pamphlet on blue paper. It's called The Blue Bomb, and became famous in political lore because that pamphlet did more to turn black votes than anything else. It turned black votes in North Carolina. The Democrats carried North Carolina. It changed, I can't remember all the states the Democrats carried that they would not have carried had it not been for that little leaflet. And it's the Atlanta student movement that made that leaflet happen.
Hmm. Okay. I think
Lonnie
actually has a copy of it. Mm-hmm.
I have a copy.
Okay. Tell me about some of the other members, like A.E. King and James Felder. What did they do?
Well, A.D. King was a funny person. I don't mean he was foolish or anything like that. He was funny. He was a jokester. And he was, in contrast to his brother, Martin, who was a serious person. I mean, he had a sense of humor, too. He could laugh and joke and so on. But A.D. could do it all the time, and Martin would do it some of the time. Ben Brown, I was especially close to Ben Brown. Brent, and you know, when we were talking about this earlier, and you mentioned his name, the thought came to me that although there was a tremendous rivalry between Morehouse and Clark, between all of the schools, each one thought it was better than the other, and knew they were better than the other, but in the movement, there was none of that. You didn't think of Ben Brown as the Clark College student. You didn't think of Lonnie King as the Morehouse College student. You thought of us as students in the AU Center. That's who we were, and that's how we thought of ourselves. And Ben was just a wonderful, wonderful guy, great, great guy. You know, he, like the rest of us, he got arrested a couple of times, these sit-ins, demonstrations, and some Georgia legislator made him promise that he would never get arrested again, or he wouldn't be able to take the bar exam. Of course, this man had no right to ask that of him. No reason he couldn't get arrested and take the bar exam too. There's no prohibition against it. It just shows you what the times were like then, and what people thought they could do then.
What about Otis Moss?
Otis Moss was older than we were, not by many years, but he appeared to be older and more serious than the rest of us. And he was very sober and very somber about things. And he had a sense of gravity about him that I think none of the rest of us did. We laughed and joked and played around and so on, and he was a serious guy. And somebody you wanted to be on your side because he was a heavyweight, an intellectual heavyweight, a heavyweight of all sorts, just a wonderful guy. And he gave us weight that we badly needed because some of us were pretty lightweighted.
Okay. Ruby Doris.
Ruby Doris Smith was a real heavyweight herself, not so much as an intellectual, because she was smart. She was a smart person, but as somebody who was fierce.
All right, here we go. Can you see my hand?
Yes, ma'am.
1, 2, 3. Good enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cell phone's off.
All right, Mr. Vaughn, tell me how and why did you get involved in the Atlanta student movement?
Well, I got in the movement because I was sitting in Yates and Milton's drugstore, killing time between classes, and a student came up to me named Lonnie King, whom I knew because he was a football player at Morehouse. We didn't have any kind of football team, but I knew him as a football player. And he held up a newspaper to me and he said, "Have you seen this?" And I thought he meant, "Do you read a newspaper?" And I thought every college student read a newspaper every day, and I was a little put off by the question. And he said, "No, no, this story, and the story about students at North Carolina A&T College sitting in for the third or fourth day." And he said, "Have you seen that?" And I said, "Yeah, I've seen that." He said, "What do you think about it?" I said, "I think it's great, it's wonderful." He said, "Don't you think it ought to happen here?" And before I could say, "What do you mean, we?" He said, "You take this side of the drugstore, and I'll take this other side, and we'll get something going." And I should say there's another, a third person in this group, Joe Pierce, who was part of the founding of the Committee on Appeal of Human Rights. So we went around to different tables and talked to different people and asked them if they thought, you know, it was worthwhile to do something like that here in Atlanta, and tried as best we could to make sure it wasn't all Morehouse, it wasn't all Clark, it wasn't all Spelman. It was difficult to make it Mars Brown because Mars Brown was a few blocks away. But over time, we made sure we had somebody from all of these schools and from Atlanta University, because we didn't want it to be a Morehouse thing or a Spelman thing alone. We wanted it to be all of the schools involved. And a couple of weeks after we began this planning, we got a notice that Dr. Clement, Rufus Clement, who was the president of Atlanta University, and in effect the president of this whole compound, wanted to see us. Well, that was a little nervy, you know, and the president of the university wants to see you. You'll have to be worried about that. He called us into his office. He said, "I know what you're going to do. I can't stop you from doing it. But before you do it, you need to find some way to let Atlanta know why you're doing it." Well, I thought, you know, we're doing it because we can't sit at these lunch counters, and we want to sit at these lunch counters. That's why we're doing it. But anyway, he was insisting. And so he suggested that we write a statement. And I, with Rosalind Brock, not Rosalind Brock, that's a cop, president of the NAACP, Rosalind Pope, and others, put together this statement, an appeal for human rights. And we based it in part on a statement drawn up by a group of older men in the community called, I can't remember what the name was, but Carl Holman, professor at Clark, was one of them. And he had written this book, this little booklet, complaining about the inequities that black people in Atlanta face. And with that as a guide, we put together this statement called An Appeal for Human Rights. And we listed the inequities that black people in Atlanta face, segregated schools, segregated buses, segregated movie theaters, all those things, and closed it by saying, we intend to take every means at our disposal to eliminate these things. We got the presidents of all of the student bodies at all of the schools to sign it, and we took it back to Dr. Clement. Dr. Clement went to Lillian Smith, white woman, a novelist, who had written a controversial book about an interracial love affair in Georgia, and she provided the money for this to be put in an ad, and we put it in the Atlanta Daily World, in the Atlanta Constitution, and the Atlanta Journal. And it was published in each of those papers as a full-page ad, and it caused an enormous controversy in white Atlanta. We talked a moment ago about Governor Vandiver saying this was not written by our students. Students couldn't write this. And I was so insulted by that because I had written part of this thing. Why do you think I couldn't do it? Was I not clever enough? He said it sounded as though it had been written in Moscow, if not Peking. I've never been to Moscow or Peking. I just thought, you know, this was the typical example of the racist element in the larger society around us, that they didn't believe we were capable of doing this. But anyway, but that's how I got involved in the movement, and next thing I knew was, here we go.
How old were you?
I was, this is 1960, I was 20 years old.
So I understand that the movement was like very militarily, strategically planned. Can you tell us some of the ways that you planned for these demonstrations?
Well, with everything that we did, we talked about it beforehand and said, "Shall we do this? No, let's do this. or let's do this plus this, or let's not do that, let's do this instead. So we didn't just jump up and run downtown and say, let's sit at these lunch counters. It's much more sophisticated than that. And this first sit-in, we divided, I can't remember how many different places we went, but I was in charge of taking a group to Atlanta City Hall. And this is before this big addition had been put on the back. So it was these stairs going up the front. You walked in the front door, and you then went downstairs to the ground floor where the cafeteria was. And I led a group of students from Spelman and Morehouse, most of them, who went to this cafeteria. And I led this group into the cafeteria. And the first thing we saw was these black women were working at the steam tables. And we went through there, and these women, I could tell, were looking at us with a mixture of fear and admiration. Fear, because they knew we were doing some of these sit-ins that they'd heard about, they'd read about in the newspaper happening other places in the South. And admiration, because they were going to be part of some kind of history. Fear, because they knew policemen are coming, and you know, black people don't like to be around policemen. At least they didn't then, and probably don't now. But we came to the steam table, they gave us our food, we came to the cashier, who was a white woman. I later discovered she was the manager of the cafeteria, and she said, she's like a Southern, like many Southerners, very polite. She said, I'm awfully sorry, this is for City Hall employees only. I said, you got a big sign out front, it says City Hall Cafeteria, the public is welcome. She said, we don't mean it. And I would have fallen down laughing if, do we need to stop?
Some miscellaneous work in this.
Okay. I found out this woman was the manager of the cafeteria. And she said, I'm awfully sorry, this is for City Hall employees only. And I said, you have a big sign on the grass outside that says City Hall Cafeteria, the public is welcome. She said, we don't mean it. And of course, I would have laughed at her face, but it was a serious moment. She said, if you don't leave now, I'm going to call the police and you'll be arrested and taken away. And so I said, we'll stay here until you allow us to eat here. And they called the police. The police came very quickly. I think Captain Little, who was a well-known Atlanta policeman, and one of the reasons why Atlanta didn't have the kind of police brutality that other cities did, I think he was sort of a sober figure there. But anyway, he came and locked us up and put us in a paddy wagon, and all of us were taken to jail. And none of us had been in jail before, and all of us, of course, were terrified at the idea of being behind bars, separated the men from the women, and put us in separate cells. And we're put in this big cell with, I'd say, about 100 men. And of course, the first thing when I saw these other men, I thought, why are they here? I know why I'm here. Why are they here? And I thought it was not proper etiquette to say, my good man, what brings you here? So I didn't say any of those things. But they knew why we were here, and they were happy to see us and proud of what we had done. And so this is the first reinforcement we got from what we had done, because the other prisoners knew why we were there. And whatever reason they were there, they were happy we had done what we were. They were proud of us, and they let us know that they were proud of us. And because so many people were arrested and so many different people, the strategy was that there would be one person tried for each group. And I was chosen to be tried for my group. So I found myself in a courtroom for the first time in my life, standing between two men whom I was informed were my lawyers, whom I had never seen before, never known before. This was Donald Hollowell, the younger man, and Austin Walden, the older man. I'm standing between these two men, and there's a little back and forth between my lawyers and then the judge, and I really don't understand what they're talking about. And all of a sudden the judge looked at me and said, how do you plead? Well, of course, I'd seen this on TV, how do you plead? And I knew that I had refused to follow the policeman's order when he ordered me to leave, so I had to be guilty of something. On the other hand, I didn't feel like I was guilty. I had a right to be in this is a tax-supported place. I was a taxpayer in Georgia. I had a right to be here, and I had every right to be there just like the judge did. But so I didn't know, am I guilty? Am I not guilty? What should I say? So I looked to Colonel Walden, who I have to tell you was sort of nodding off like this. And so he was no help. So I turned to Donald Hollowell, who was the younger of the two men, and he said, not guilty, you fool. And so I was quick enough to drop those last two words, or else I might not be sitting here right now. So that's how I got in the movement. And then I got bailed out, as the rest of us did, got bailed out later that day. And I remember going to Spelman, because I thought my heroism needed to be reflected in the eyes of a Spelman co-ed. And I can't remember what we did, but I went over to Spelman with somebody else, so we could say, you know, we were just arrested. Of course, there were girls from Spelman, or young women from Spelman who'd been arrested too, but I don't think they felt the same way about it.
Great story.
Didn't report it?
Did you hear it?
No.
So did you get any play?
That's for another story.
When you were planning, Lonnie was telling me the story about, I don't remember the gentleman's name, I think it was Bennett or something, planned out everything. He was ex-military, and we had names like Commandante and that type of thing. What was your name? What was your position?
I didn't have a name, except my own name. But I don't know why, but I'd always been interested in writing. And while a student at Morehouse, I wanted somehow to become a writer. And I had helped to found a literary magazine at Morehouse called The Pegasus, and published that for a couple of issues. So I was just bent toward writing. And somehow or another, I found myself saying, I'm going to be the publicist. I'm going to be the guy who talks to the media. I'm going to be the person who tells the media what we've done and why we've done it and so on. I'm going to be the interlocutor between the movement and the media. And so that's the role I fell into. And I don't know how I got into that role, or who said, okay, or that's all right, you can do it. But that's the role I undertook. And so I became the PR person for the movement. So over the next several years, after the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee was founded, I took on that job for them. But I took that job first for the Atlanta Student Movement. And I got to know all of the reporters who covered civil rights. There's one guy named Raleigh Bryan. I'm just rethinking his name here. I'm sure he's going on to his reward now, but he was sympathetic to the movement, and he covered the movement for it. Another one named Fred Powledge, who worked for the Journal or Constitution, one of those two papers, and he covered us with some decency and thoughtfulness. I got to know the New York Times reporter, who was among the most important persons to know, because if you get in the New York Times, you're really big time. His name was Claude Sitton, and he created the little reporter's notebook that you see, like it's about this big. And what he did was he took a regular notebook and cut it in half, and that was what was left. And he could put it in his coat, and nobody would see it, and he'd pull it out again. So I got to know him, and I got to know that he was a person worth being close to, and somebody who would treat us fairly, who would tell our story the way we wanted it to be told, wouldn't stretch anything, wouldn't tell lies or anything about us, but he was a good guy, and having him on your side was like gold.
Wow, good experience. Okay. At one point, the newspaper, we're talking about these articles, newspaper account said that the marchers seemed to suddenly appear, leaving the KKK always a step behind, not knowing where to stage their counter demonstration. How were you able to do that?
I think we were quick, we were young, we got from here to there very quickly. We decided if they're over here, we're going to go over there. Or we may even go where they are and show them that we're not afraid of them. You know, typically, in every city in the South, where the Ku Klux Klan showed its face, black people ran like this. But we weren't going to run from anybody. We wanted to do anything to show these people we were afraid of them, because we were not afraid of them. They looked silly with these little hats. You know why they wear those pointed hats? That's to make up for physical inadequacies in other parts of their bodies. That was our attitude toward these people. They looked stupid. They looked foolish. And we weren't going to let them push us around.
Okay. Was Martin Luther King ever consulted by the group or did anything with the group?
Lonnie King was attended Ebenezer Baptist Church, and he knew Dr. King as his pastor. And I knew him because I took a class that he taught at Morehouse College. You know, a lot of people say they were students of Dr. King's. He only taught one time, only taught one class, only eight people in the class. I'm one of the eight, So if you hear somebody say that he was a student of Dr. King's and he wasn't in that class, he's telling a big lie. But I was a student, so I knew Dr. King from that, and Lonnie knew him from being his in his congregation at Ebenezer Baptist Church. And when we were going to sit in at Rich's, because Rich's was the biggest store, still is, I guess, and if you could break the back of Rich's, you break the back of segregation in restaurants in Atlanta. So we wanted badly for King to be arrested with us, because we thought, and Lonnie thought, that if we could get Dr. King arrested in Atlanta, and you know, this was right in the middle of a presidential campaign, John F. Kennedy and Richard Nixon vying for which of them is going to be president of the United States, each of them will be forced to make some comment about this. And the one that makes the best comment is going to be the recipient of black votes. And so we, in effect, helped influence the outcome of the presidential election in 1960. Because after King was arrested, his campaign apparatus put together a phony group of black clergymen, including the leadership of it was William Gray, who was the father of the late Congressman William Gray. And they put together this pamphlet on blue paper. It's called The Blue Bomb, and became famous in political lore because that pamphlet did more to turn black votes than anything else. It turned black votes in North Carolina. The Democrats carried North Carolina. It changed, I can't remember all the states the Democrats carried that they would not have carried had it not been for that little black leaflet. And it's the Atlanta student movement that made that leaflet happen.
Hmm. Okay. I think
Lonnie
actually has a copy of it. Mm-hmm. You mentioned it yesterday.
I have a copy.
Tell me about some of the other members, like A. E. King and James Felder. What did they do?
Well, A. D. King was a funny person. I don't mean he was foolish or anything like that. He was funny. He was a jokester, and he was in contrast to his brother Martin, who was a serious person. I mean, he had a sense of humor too. He could laugh and joke and so on. But A. D. could do it all the time, and Martin would do it some of the time. Ben Brown, I was especially close to Ben Brown. Brent, and you know, when we were talking about this earlier, and you mentioned his name, the thought came to me that although there was a tremendous rivalry between Morehouse and Clark, between all of the schools, each one thought it was better than the other, and knew they were better than the other, but in the movement, there was none of that. You didn't think of Ben Brown as the Clark College student. You didn't think of Lonnie King as the Morehouse College student. You thought of us as students in the AU Center. That's who we were, and that's how we thought of ourselves. And Ben was just a wonderful, wonderful guy, great, great guy. You know, he, like the rest of us, he got arrested a couple of times, these sit-ins demonstrations, and some Georgia legislator made him promise that he would never get arrested again, or he wouldn't be able to take the bar exam. Of course, this man had no right to ask that of him. No reason he couldn't get arrested and take the bar exam too. There's no prohibition against it. It just shows you what the times were like then, and what people thought they could do then.
What about Otis Moss?
Otis Moss was older than we were, not by many years, but he appeared to be older and more serious than the rest of us. And he was very sober, very somber about things, and he had a sense of gravity about him that I think none of the rest of us did. We laughed and joked and played around and so on, and he was a serious guy, and somebody you wanted to be on your side because he was a heavyweight, an intellectual heavyweight, a heavyweight of all sorts, just a wonderful guy, and he gave us weight that we badly needed because some of us were pretty lightweighted.
Okay. Ruby Doris.
Ruby Doris Smith was a real heavyweight herself. Not so much as an intellectual, because she was smart. She was a smart person. But as somebody who was fierce.
All right, here we go. Can you see my hand?
Yes, ma'am.
One, two, three. Enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're good? All right.
Cell phone's off.
Yes. All right. Mr. Bond, tell me how and why did you get involved in the Atlanta student movement?
Well, I got in the movement because I was sitting in Yates and Milton's drugstore, killing time between classes, and a student came up to me named Lonnie King, whom I knew because he was a football player at Morehouse. We didn't have any kind of football team, but I knew him as a football player. And he held up a newspaper to me and he said, "Have you seen this?" And I thought he meant, "Do you read a newspaper?" And I thought every college student read a newspaper every day, and I was a little put off by the question. And he said, no, this story, and the story about students at North Carolina A&T College sitting in for the third or fourth day. And he said, "Have you seen that?" And I said, "Yeah, I've seen that." He said, "What do you think about it?" I said, "I think it's great, it's wonderful." He said, "Don't you think it ought to happen here?" And before I could say, "What do you mean, we?" He said, "You take this side of the drugstore, and I'll take this other side, and we'll get something going." And I should say, there's another, a third person in this group, Joe Pierce, who was part of the founding of the student of the Committee on Appeal for Human Rights. So we went around to different tables and talked to different people and asked them if they thought, you know, it was worthwhile to do something like that here in Atlanta, and tried as best we could to make sure it wasn't all Morehouse, it wasn't all Clark, it wasn't all Spelman. It was difficult to make it Mars Brown because Mars Brown was a few blocks away. But over time, we made sure we had somebody from all of these schools and from Atlanta University, because we didn't want it to be a Morehouse thing or a Spelman thing alone. We wanted it to be all of the schools involved. And a couple of weeks after we began this planning, we got a notice that Dr. Clement, Rufus Clement, who was the president of Atlanta University, and in effect the president of this whole compound, wanted to see us. Well, that was a little nervy, you know, and the president of the university wants to see you. You don't have to be worried about that. He called us into his office. He said, "I know what you're going to do. I can't stop you from doing it. But before you do it, you need to find some way to let Atlanta know why you're doing it." Well, I thought, you know, we're doing it because we can't sit at these lunch counters, and we want to sit at these lunch counters. That's why we're doing it. But anyway, he was insistent. And so he suggested that we write a statement. And I, with Rosalind Brock, not Rosalind Brock, that's a cop, president of the NAACP, Rosalind Pope, and others, put together this statement, an appeal for human rights. And we based it in part on a statement drawn up by a group of older men in the community called, I can't remember what the name was, but Carl Holman, professor at Clark, was one of them. And he had written this book, this little booklet, complaining about the inequities that black people in Atlanta face. And with that as a guide, we put together this statement called An Appeal for Human Rights. And we listed the inequities that black people in Atlanta face, segregated schools, segregated buses, segregated movie theaters, all those things, and closed it by saying, we intend to take every means at our disposal to eliminate these things. We got the presidents of all of the student bodies at all of the schools to sign it, and we took it back to Dr. Clement. Dr. Clement went to Lillian Smith, white woman, a novelist, who had written a controversial book about an interracial love affair in Georgia, and she provided the money for this to be put in an ad, and we put it in the Atlanta Daily World, and the Atlanta Constitution, and the Atlanta Journal. And it was published in each of those papers as a full-page ad, and it caused an enormous controversy in white Atlanta. We talked a moment ago about Governor Vandiver saying this was not written by our students. Students couldn't write this. And I was so insulted by that because I had written part of this thing. Why do you think I couldn't do it? Was I not clever enough? He said it sounded as though it had been written in Moscow, if not Peking. I've never been to Moscow or Peking. I just thought, you know, this was the typical example of the racist element in the larger society around us, that they didn't believe we were capable of doing this. But anyway, that's how I got involved in the movement, and next thing I knew was, here we go.
How old were you?
I was, this is 1960, I was 20 years old.
So, I understand that the movement was like very militarily, strategically planned. Can you tell us some of the ways that you planned for these demonstrations?
Well, with everything that we did, we talked about it beforehand and said, shall we do this? No, let's do this. Or let's do this plus this. Or let's not do that, let's do this instead. So we didn't just jump up and run downtown and say, let's sit at these lunch counters. It's much more sophisticated than that. And this first sit-in, we divided, I can't remember how many different places we went, but I was in charge of taking a group to Atlanta City Hall. And this is before this big addition had been put on the back. So it was these stairs going up the front. You walked in the front door, and you then went downstairs to the ground floor where the cafeteria was. And I led a group of students from Spelman and Morehouse, most of them, who went to this cafeteria. And I led this group into the cafeteria. And the first thing we saw was these black women were working at the steam tables. And we went through there, and these women, I could tell, were looking at us with a mixture of fear and admiration. Fear, because they knew we were doing some of these sit-ins that they'd heard about, they'd read about in the newspaper, happening other places in the South. And admiration, because they're going to be part of some kind of history. Fear, because they knew policemen are coming, and you know, black people don't like to be around policemen. At least they didn't then, they probably don't now. But we came to the steam table, they gave us our food, we came to the cashier, who was a white woman. I later discovered she was the manager of the cafeteria, and she said, she's like a Southern, like many Southerners, very polite. She said, I'm awfully sorry, this is for City Hall employees only. I said, you got a big sign out front that says City Hall Cafeteria, the public is welcome. She said, we don't mean it. And I would have fallen down laughing if we need to stop.
Some miscellaneous part of this.
Okay. I found out this woman was the manager of the cafeteria. And she said, I'm awfully sorry, this is for City Hall employees only. And I said, you have a big sign on the grass outside that says City Hall Cafeteria, the public is welcome. She said, we don't mean it. And of course, I would have laughed in her face, but it was a serious moment. She said, if you don't leave now, I'm going to call the police and you'll be arrested and taken away. And so I said, we'll stay here until you allow us to eat here. And they called the police. The police came very quickly. I think Captain Little, who was a well-known Atlanta policeman, and one of the reasons why Atlanta didn't have the kind of police brutality that other cities did, I think he was sort of a sober figure there. But anyway, he came and locked us up and put us in a paddy wagon, and all of us were taken to jail. And none of us had been to jail before, and all of us, of course, were terrified at the idea of being behind bars, separated the men from the women, and put us in separate cells. And we're put in this big cell with, I'd say, about 100 men. And of course, the first thing when I saw these other men, I thought, why are they here? I know why I'm here. Why are they here? And I thought it was not proper etiquette to say, my good man, what brings you here? So I didn't say any of those things. But they knew why we were here, and they were happy to see us and proud of what we had done. And so this is the first reinforcement we got from what we had done, because the other prisoners knew why we were there, and whatever reason they were there, they were happy we had done what we were. They were proud of us, and they let us know that they were proud of us. And because so many people were arrested and so many different people, the strategy was that there'd be one person tried for each group, and I was chosen to be tried for my group. So I found myself in a courtroom for the first time in my life, standing between two men whom I was informed were my lawyers, whom I'd never seen before, never known before. This was Donald Hollowell, the younger man, and Austin Walden, the older man. I'm standing between these two men, and there's a little back and forth between my lawyers and the judge, and I really don't understand what they're talking about. And all of a sudden the judge looked at me and said, how do you plead? Well, of course, I'd seen this on TV, how do you plead? And I knew that I had refused to follow the policeman's order when he ordered me to leave, so I had to be guilty of something. On the other hand, I didn't feel like I was guilty. I had a right to be in this is a tax-supported place. I was a taxpayer in Georgia. I had a right to be here, and I had every right to be there just like the judge did. But so I didn't know, am I guilty? Am I not guilty? What should I say? So I looked to Colonel Walden, who I have to tell you was sort of nodding off like this. And so he was no help. So I turned to Donald Hollowell, who was the younger of the two men, and he said, not guilty, you fool. And so I was quick enough to drop those last two words, or else I might not be sitting here right now. So that's how I got in the movement. And then I got bailed out, as the rest of us did, got bailed out later that day. And I remember going to Spelman, because I thought my heroism needed to be reflected in the eyes of a Spelman co-ed. And I can't remember what we did, but I went over to Spelman with somebody else, so we could say, you know, we were just arrested. But of course, there were girls from Spelman, or young women from Spelman who'd been arrested too, but I don't think they felt the same way about it.
Great story.
Didn't report it?
Huh?
Did you
hear it?
No.
So did you get any play?
Did you get any play?
That's for another story.
When you were planning, Lonnie was telling me the story about, and I don't remember the gentleman's name, I think it was Bennett or something, planned out everything. He was ex-military, and we had names like Commandante and that type of thing. What was your name? What was your position?
I didn't have a name, except my own name. But I don't know why, but I'd always been interested in writing. And while a student at Morehouse, I wanted somehow to become a writer. And I had helped to found a literary magazine at Morehouse called The Pegasus, and published that for a couple of issues. So I just bent toward writing, and somehow or another I found myself saying, I'm going to be the publicist. I'm going to be the guy who talks to the media. I'm going to be the person who tells the media what we've done and why we've done it and so on. I'm going to be the interlocutor between the movement and the media. And so that's the role I fell into, and I don't know how I got into that role, or who said, okay, or that's all right, you can do it, but that's the role I undertook. And so I became the PR person for the movement. So over the next several years, after the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee was founded, I took on that job for them. But I took that job first for the Atlanta Student Movement. And I got to know all of the reporters who covered civil rights. There's one guy named Raleigh Bryan. I'm just rethinking his name here. I'm sure he's going on to his reward now, but he was sympathetic to the movement, and he covered the movement for it. Another one named Fred Powledge, who worked for the Journal or Constitution, one of those two papers, and he covered us with some decency and thoughtfulness. I got to know the New York Times reporter, who was among the most important person to know, because if you get in the New York Times, you're really big time. His name was Claude Sitton, and he created the little reporter's notebook that you see, like it's about this big. And what he did was he took a regular notebook and cut it in half, and that was what was left. And he put it in his coat, and nobody would see it, and he pulled it out and pulled it out again. So I got to know him, and I got to know that he was a person worth being close to, and somebody who would treat us fairly, who would tell our story the way we wanted it to be told, wouldn't stretch anything, wouldn't tell lies or anything about us, but he was a good guy, and having him on your side was like gold.
Wow, that experience. At one point, the newspaper, in talking about these articles, newspaper account said that the marchers seemed to suddenly appear, leaving the KKK always a step behind, not knowing where to stage their counter demonstration. How were you able to do that?
I think we were quick, we were young, we got from here to there very quickly. We decided if they're over here, we're going to go over there. Or we may even go where they are and show them that we're not afraid of them. You know, typically, in every city in the South, where the Ku Klux Klan showed its face, black people ran like this. But we weren't going to run from anybody. We wanted to do anything to show these people we were afraid of them, because we were not afraid of them. They look silly with these little hats. You know why they wear those pointed hats? That's to make up for physical inadequacies in other parts of their bodies. That was our attitude toward these people. They looked stupid. They looked foolish. And we weren't going to let them push us around.
Was Martin Luther King ever consulted by the group, or did anything with the group?
Lonnie King was attended Ebenezer Baptist Church, and he knew Dr. King as his pastor. And I knew him because I took a class that he taught at Morehouse College. You know, a lot of people say they were students of Dr. King's. He only taught one time, only taught one class, only 8 people in the class. I'm one of the 8. So if you hear somebody say that he was a student of Dr. King's and he wasn't in that class, he's telling a big lie. But I was a student, so I knew Dr. King from that, and Lonnie knew him from being his, in his congregation at Ebenezer Baptist Church. And when we were going to sit in at Rich's, because Rich's was the biggest store, still is, I guess, and if you could break the back of Rich's, you break the back of segregation in restaurants in Atlanta. So we wanted badly for King to be arrested with us, because we thought, and Lonnie thought, that if we could get Dr. King arrested in Atlanta, and you know, this was right in the middle of a presidential campaign, John F. Kennedy and Richard Nixon vying for which of them is going to be president of the United States, each of them will be forced to make some comment about this. And the one that makes the best comment is going to be the recipient of black votes. And so we, in effect, helped influence the outcome of the presidential election in 1960. Because after King was arrested, his campaign apparatus put together a phony group of black clergymen, including the leadership of it was William Gray, who was the father of the late Congressman William Gray. And they put together this pamphlet on blue paper. It's called The Blue Bomb, and became famous in political lore because that pamphlet did more to turn black votes than anything else. It turned black votes in North Carolina. The Democrats carried North Carolina. It changed, I can't remember all the states the Democrats carried that they would not have carried had it not been for that little black leaflet. And it's the Atlanta student movement that made that leaflet happen.
Hmm. Okay. I think Lonnie actually has a copy of it. You mentioned it yesterday.
I have a copy.
Tell me about some of the other members, like A. E. King and James Felder. What did they do?
Well, A. D. King was a funny person. I don't mean he was foolish or anything like that. He was funny. He was a jokester, and he was in contrast to his brother Martin, who was a serious person. I mean, he had a sense of humor too. He could laugh and joke and so on. But A. D. could do it all the time, and Martin would do it some of the time. Ben Brown, I was especially close to Ben Brown. Brent, and you know, when we were talking about this earlier, and you mentioned his name, the thought came to me that although there was a tremendous rivalry between Morehouse and Clark, between all of the schools, each one thought it was better than the other, and knew they were better than the other, but in the movement, there was none of that. You didn't think of Ben Brown as the Clark College student. You didn't think of Lonnie King as the Morehouse College student. You thought of us as students in the AU Center. That's who we were, and that's how we thought of ourselves. And Ben was just a wonderful, wonderful guy, great, great guy. You know, he, like the rest of us, he got arrested a couple of times at these sit-ins demonstrations, and some Georgia legislator made him promise that he would never get arrested again, or he wouldn't be able to take the bar exam. Of course, this man had no right to ask that of him. No reason he couldn't get arrested and take the bar exam too. There's no prohibition against it. It just shows you what the times were like then, and what people thought they could do then.
What about Otis Moss?
Otis Moss was older than we were, not by many years, but he appeared to be older and more serious than the rest of us. And he was very sober, very somber about things, and he had a sense of gravity about him that I think none of the rest of us did. We laughed and joked and played around and so on, and he was a serious guy, and somebody you wanted to be on your side because he was a heavyweight, an intellectual heavyweight, a heavyweight of all sorts, just a wonderful guy, and he gave us weight that we badly needed because some of us were pretty lightweighted.
Okay. Ruby Doris.
Ruby Doris Smith was a real heavyweight herself, not so much as an intellectual, because she was smart, she was a smart person, but as somebody who was fierce,